Something we use quite a lot in C# these days is what's known as deferred execution, which is where we configure some functionality at one point in the program and then execute it at a later stage. And this is used in situations like, particularly when we've got link, but also when we've got async and await, and when we've got yield return functions. And it's a very powerful technique, but it does lead to one slight problem, particularly when you're dealing with exceptions. Let me show you what I mean. What I've got here is an application where I've just got the usual author and books as some data types, and I've got a DB context to store those. And then the actual DB I've put together here is simply an in-memory database. So we did a video a little while back on in-memory databases. Their chief functionality is for unit testing. They're certainly not something you'd want to use in real application code, but they're quite handy here just for doing a quick demo without having to properly configure a database. So that's what we've got. I create a load of dummy data, so a couple of authors, each with a couple of books. Nothing special there. But then the thing that's of interest is I've put into this library accessor class this method called byDate, where we have the low year and the high year, and then we just do a query where we're looking for books whose year of publication is between those two dates. And then we execute that query with a toArray async. So that's an async function. We have to await it. And that also means that this byDate function must also be async. So that's the function we've got. We use that then in our program here. So I've got this test async, and we create the accessor, and then I've popped out a couple of messages just to show us where we are in the flow of the program. But there is where I call the accessor byDate. Because byDate was an async function, then I do the await on that, and that gives us back our list of matching books between 1950 and 1960. Another message shows where we are, and then we print them out. So if I run that up, then pretty simply, we get the two messages. So first we form the query, then having formed the query, execute it, and then we loop through the books, and we've got those two between the matching dates. But we don't have to do it quite like that, because we could not await it quite so early. So if we call the accessor by date and just put that straight back into books, because we haven't awaited it, books now contains something slightly differently. It doesn't now contain the iNumerable book, it contains the task of iNumerable book, which is what the return type actually is on that function. And that's not much use, we can't for each through that, but we can put the await later on. That's the flexibility we've got here. So once you've got your task, you can await it immediately, or you can await it later on where we use it. And that's the deferred execution. So here we formed up the function, and here we're actually executing it. So it's not a huge distance between where we're forming up this query and where we're executing it. But once you've got that principle, you could have created that books task a lot earlier on and executed a lot later on. Now, it doesn't look like it matters too much, but let's now just extend it a little bit. And what we can do is we will put some extra code in here as a safety test. So what I'm going to do is, if high year is less than low year, well, that can't be right, because those should be the range. If high year is less than low year, we're guaranteed not get anything. We count that as an error. So what we'll do is we'll do a throw new argument exception, and then we'll just put in as a message, high year is earlier than low year. And so that's just a safety check you might have on any query. Let's just go back and move our await to the earlier point. So pop that in there. And let's also make it so that it does have an error. And then if we run that, we can see, we say first we form the query, so we've hit that part in the code, and then we get the exception thrown, and it's caught up there, just popping out the error message 1940 rather than 1950. So that's all perfectly reasonable. But if we had deferred the execution, so if I put the await back down here and run the same thing, then you can see that the error is coming out later. So as well as saying we form the query, we're saying we form the query, now let's execute it, and it's only on the first iteration of the for each loop, when the await actually hits, that it then does the check and gives us the error. And as I say, if those two were a long way apart in the program, that could be quite confusing, because the error is fundamental. The error occurs as soon as we try to do the by date, that's just never going to work because the dates are the wrong way around. It's not an error that was only spotted when we hit the first iteration of getting the books. It's earlier than that, and so we should be reporting it as early as possible, not when we do the await, when we actually call the by date. But the reason it doesn't work like that is what the async actually causes the compiler to do is take all of this code, wrap it up in the task that's being returned, and that's why it's only when we execute the task with the await later on down here that it bothers to check on the exception and gives us the error. And that's not really very nice to the user. They should be told as soon as is possible that 1940 is earlier than 1950 and therefore it's invalid. The way we can get around that is actually to break it down into two separate functions, because we have this bit of the function that we want to be executed immediately, and it's only this bit of the function that we want to be deferred. So if we split them up, we can get that to work. So what we do is this. We put in another function. This one is going to be private. Make it async. We're going to again return the task of our enumerable book. And let's just call this the async bit. It's going to take in the parameters. And then it's basically just going to have the part without the range checking. And then in here, we're going to remove the async. So this code is not going to be packaged up into a task. So that means we do the check and the exception throwing instantaneously. And then we simply return the task we have from here. So async bit, and then pass in low year and high year. And now if we run that up, we can see that we get the error straight away. So our program code is still doing the await later on after the we form the query message, but we're getting it straight away. And it doesn't matter now whether we put the await early on, we get the error message instantaneously, or if we do it late on, we still get the error message instantaneously. And that's going to be much better for anyone using this code to be told they've got something wrong as soon as possible. And as you saw, we did it by splitting this up. We have a non-async function which has the code we want to be executed immediately, and then an async function which simply has the code that we do want to have the deferred execution for. Now that said, doing it the private method like that has a few drawbacks. We've made it private, so nobody outside the class is going to call it accidentally. But even so, someone inside the class could call this bit directly without doing the bounds check on the high year and the low year. And also, it's just a bit fiddly setting that all up in syntax. So a slightly better way we can do it is this. We can have a local function inside the by date rather than having a separate private function. So what we can do is take that code and pop it straight into the parent function, the by date. Obviously, it's no longer going to be private. It's still going to be async. It's still going to be called async bit. But then the other nice thing about that is, because a local function, as long as it's non-static, can capture the data from the parent function, we don't need to pass in the parameters. It will just pick them up because they're still in scope from the parent function. So that's doing the same thing, but in a rather simpler way, because we don't have to expose, even though only within the class, this private method. It's entirely local now. And that will still work in the same way. So if we go back to the program, and at the moment we're doing the deferred execution, but if we run that, we still get the error straight away before we hit the we form the query. And obviously if we do the await earlier on, then that's going to work in the same way. So not an earth-changing way of doing things, but certainly very nice for anyone using your function if you can make it so that they will get any obvious errors as early as possible, not lulled into a false sense of security by thinking, okay, we've called the function, it's worked, and then getting the error later on. So nice little trick there that we can do to split it up into the bit that we want to be async, the bit that we want to be immediate. I mentioned this applies in other areas as well. Just quickly, we'll look at another one of those where we're using yield return. So I've put in another function in here, which again is something we saw earlier on when we were looking at yield return. This is using yield return to generate a Fibonacci sequence. So I won't go into too much detail here because you can look at the earlier video, but basically we have this enumerable int. We specify the maximum number of terms we want from the Fibonacci series, and loop through up to that. But then we use yield return so that each term is generated on the fly rather than them all being generated up front. And so you can see if in our program we ask for 10 items in the sequence, again, I've put some messages so we can see where we are in that process, and we then loop through and print them out. And so if we run that up, there we get the first 10 items in the Fibonacci sequence starting at 0. But again, there's a potential problem in terms of exceptions, because, for example, if I ask for a Fibonacci sequence of just one element and I run that, well, actually, I get two elements. The reason being that if we look in the Fibonacci sequence, the first two elements, 0 and 1, are always given to us regardless of the length. The length only comes into play later on. Now, we could put some extra code around that, but a simple way would simply to put another test in. So we can say if length is less than 2, then we're going to throw new argument out of range exception, and then what we'll put in here is the parameter is going to be name of length, and then the message length must be at least 2. So very similar sort of thing, and it's going to follow the same sort of lines. So if we run that up with 1 in there, then again we've got the same problem. We only hit the error when we actually start iterating through. We don't hit the error when we actually make the mistake of passing 1 into the sequence. So same sort of problem as we had with the async await, and it's the same solution. So if we go back to the Fibonacci, and then what we'll do is in here, I'm going to put another function that returns inumber of int. I'm going to call this local generate. No need to pass in any parameters because, again, it will capture the length. Put that in there. And then the last thing we do here is we just call local generate and return it. And again, because the sequence function doesn't contain any yield return statements, then it's just a normal function that will get called immediately. It's only the local generate that does contain yield return that will be set up for deferred execution when we actually call it. So now we're going to see that when we run that up, now we get the error as soon as we call the sequence. We don't wait till we start iterating the sequence. Again, much more useful to be told immediately when you're the programmer, when you're using this, that you've got something wrong. So that's it, a really neat technique, something that's easy to forget because in many situations, although we may have an async function that's available to be deferred, we don't actually defer it, and so you get any error messages straight away. But just bear in mind, if it's an error in the parameters that can be spotted immediately, not an error in the data itself that can only be spotted when you're doing the iteration process, then you're going to be much more friendly if you can report that immediately to your client code when it's calling. So, hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do click like. We've talked a bit about yield return and async and await in all sorts of videos. If you're interested in more of these detailed features, do pop a message and let me know. But also, do click like, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.